Thank you, Nihargana Dhar. Now I invite Sriza Sahai, Department of History, Delhi University.
The topic of my paper is understanding art through a gendered perspective, and therefore I'll be looking at the methodology through which we can read art in specific reference to how to read gender in it. So, gender becomes one of the many lenses through which a study of visual can be undertaken. Any object that thus needs to be subjected to questions of how to read such a source or the context in which it's placed, the identity of the artist and the sources of patronage. Its current situation further adds another degree of interaction with the source. The paper attempts at locating gender via study of celestial females, and further by focusing on the example of the famous Didarkanj Yakshi and the issue of gaze in the process of engendering the visual. Now, firstly, it's very crucial to understand that there's a difference between sex and gender. Gender is a social construct that influences the individual psychological arena due to its potent presence in the normative behavior. Gender, therefore, is also performative in its essence, which is predetermined by the norms of the society and the context in which one exists. Sex, on the other hand, is a very biological entity. So, also, therefore, the study of art via gender is an activity that looks at the society as well. Female body becomes the location of engendering process that during the 19th century had an attached stereotype of racist ideas of sexuality and eroticism. The case of Sarah Bachman, the picture, is also known as, derogatively known as, the Hottentot Venus, is a case in point. Further, while depictions of the Laja Gauri and sculptures were very representations of fertility and of women in nature, however, the identity of the female was reduced to a virtue of procreation. But they also allowed a misreading of these sculptures as depictions of the shameless woman or the nude squatting goddess. The paper, as it focuses on the celestial females, it is important to understand what do we mean by celestial. Celestial refers to the beings that reside in the ethereal realm, but without the powerful presence and responsibilities of the divine. Durga, therefore, cannot be measured in the same scale as Urvashi. These celestial females consist of the images of Apsaras, Yakshis and Sursundaris, among others, who are generally portrayed in the nude. So, while we are looking at these sculptures, we must also understand that the current parameters of beauty were not as same as the ancient one. So, thin and tall did not conform to the ancient ideas of what beautiful was. Similarly, Victorian sensibilities were titillated and horrified at the same time when they were confronted with these overtly sensual and bold sculptural representations of these celestial females. Shobha means beauty and Shubha means auspiciousness, and both of them share the same root. Therefore, effectively stating, it can be stated that that which is beautiful is also auspicious, which basically makes sense if you're looking at the placement of these sculptures on temple walls. So it was not only for the purpose of beautification, but also for harbingering auspiciousness. These sculptures created a cycle of reciprocal fertility, wherein the trees and the woman's fertile nature was being celebrated. Linda Neath states that the feminine body is both mater and materia, and thus the representation of the nude is of the nature in its purest form. But while we are looking at all of these sculptures, it is also important to remember that a balance must be made between the viewing of men and women as socio-sexual entities and in the domains of spirituality wherein they are respectively located. While evidence of agency in women, of women is evidently present in patronage, it is the depiction of women in visual arts that adheres to stereotyping. Exceptions of the divine feminine aside, the portrayal of feminine figure has been imagined as voluptuous and in attractive postures gazing towards the self. The Alaskanya figures are depicted in various poses of pulling a thorn, the right one I think is pulling a thorn, and or drying her hair, among others, that ooze sensuality. These scenes that are so common in the daily lives are presented in a manner that arouses the male gaze and plays to the voyeuristic tendencies. A female body thus becomes the symbol of male fantasies that are forced upon it, thereby molding her into an object of desire. Now, coming to the case study of Didarkanj Yakshi, it's a very famous Yakshi. She's a celestial figure and it is currently located in the Bihar Patna Museum. A very clear eroticization was seen accompanying this process. The representation of the feminine figures during this period, this is 2nd century BCE, Chunar Buff Sandstone, It was characterized by large breasts, small waists and wide hips. In case of the Darganj Yakshi, it was a large breast that became the central focus of the male gaze. During the 19th century, with the discovery of the Yakshi, it saw various reactions emerging from awe to its splendor to horror at such depictions. Cunningham went so far to draw the conclusion that such forms of deportment, that is semi-nude but heavily ornamented, must have been preferred publicly by a certain class of women during the ancient Indian times. One of the more overt reactions that can be seen through a poetry composition in the 1960s, it went on to describe the physical features of the Yakshi explicitly while using terms such as broad thighs, feasting senses, or breasts between whose two sons runs a ivory necklace. This amalgamation of the overtly sexual symbolism with the reproductive nature of the feminine body found a representation in the aesthetic arena, wherein the being of a female coalesced in her sexual appeal and a role as a progenitor. Concluding, Panofsky states that the description of art should not be confused while analysis, while studying Indian art. A simple discussion of the object, as in how many hands, how many legs, what is she wearing, is very different from trying to read intentions in art. Therefore, any study of art is not isolationist in its nature. Gender is only one of the lenses through which we can look at it, not be it ended. So whether it's Manet's Olympia that hints at the changing social conditions of working class women in the realism era of France or others, in case of ancient Indian art, the artist is very rarely known and operates under a shroud of anonymity. Thereby, rendering gendered discourses becomes a task of recognizing the very embedded nature of gender in art and placing it in the larger context of historical changes that were occurring to further understand the varied influences in art. Therefore, it can be said conclusively that visual sources are very deeply engendered. Thank you.